Hello, my friends. This is Jessum Guy, and this is Jessum Guy's podcast, and this is episode 2.
So I began to put these things together and discovered that this group was working for the following things. They were a secret group. They were working to federate the English-speaking world, the English-speaking world. They were closely linked to international bankers. They were working to establish a world, what I call a three-power world. And that three-power world was the Atlantic bloc of England and the Commonwealth and the United States, Germany, Hitler's Germany, Soviet Russia, the three-power world. They said, Germany we can control because it's boxed in, and all of this is in my book, it's boxed in between the Atlantic bloc and the Russians. The Russians will behave because they're boxed in between the Atlantic bloc, the American Navy and Singapore and so forth, and the Germans, do you see?
Right.
And therefore, now this is all described in my book, and this was their idea. Now notice, it's a balance of power system.
What you just heard was a clip of an interview by Rudy Maxa of the Washington Post of Professor Carol Quigley about his magnum opus, Tragedy and Hope. Tragedy and Hope was the book that sort of changed everything for me once I got my hands on it quite a few years ago. Completely changed how I see everything. We're going to spend the next few episodes breaking down all 1,300 pages of it. Just relevant ones. About 320 of those. So, who is Carol Quigley? Professor Quigley, he obtained his AB, his MA, and his PhD degrees from Harvard University. He taught government and history at both Princeton and Harvard. Later went to Georgetown University, where he was the professor of history for the School of Foreign Services. He also was a consultant to the U.S. Department of Defense, the Navy, Department of State. He was also advisor to the Congressional Select Committee that created NASA, and advisor to the Smithsonian Institute. He was also the mentor to future President Bill Clinton, who publicly recognized him in a speech to the Democratic National Convention in 1992, where he said, "As a teenager, I heard John Kennedy summons to citizenship. And then as a student at Georgetown, I heard that call clarified by a professor named Carol Quigley." So the story goes, according to Quigley, that they were preparing officers to go to Europe for occupation for World War I, and he was teaching these officers 20th century world and European history. They decided to set up the ASTP, which is the Army Specialized Training Program, which essentially it was to train American soldiers for military occupation of overseas countries once they were defeated. So he said essentially Tragedy and Hope came out of all of these lectures. So this was in 1941. He says he met Alfred Zimmern in 1947. Now, this, he disclosed to him that he had been a member of the secretive roundtable groups since 1913, and he was recruited because of his involvement in the Educational Alliance Organization directly by Lord Milner. So, he was brought in, Quigley was sort of brought in, kind of, to this group around that time, and spent the next 20 years of his life researching these roundtable groups, including, you know, Council on Foreign Relations and the Royal Institute of International Affairs. He got access to, you know, Council on Foreign Relations archives. So he has an intimate knowledge of the inner workings of these roundtable groups. And so Tragedy and Hope is a combination of his vast knowledge of world, European and American history of the 18th and 19th century, combined with the inner workings of the money powers and the roundtable groups that were central to essentially what became two world wars, and even going back as far as the revolutions that he will let us know. It's also important to note that Quigley is not a whistleblower. He is an apologist. He says himself that he agrees with them. He sees that what they are doing is good and is necessary to sort of save humanity. And he only disagreed with a few minor things, mainly, you know, economically. There's going to be propaganda in this book because he's trying to, again, justify what these people have done. He's trying to justify that this has been good. And he says himself that, you know, tragedy and hope was named because it's a tragedy that it was starting to fall apart, and that these people sort of gave, you know, what he felt was the only hope of survival of Western civilization.
The group that I'm writing about was originally, in my mind, the group established secretly by Lord Milner in 1908 and 1909 called the Round Table Group, which still publishes a quarterly magazine called the Round Table in London, which is one of the world's best sources of international relations information since 1910. The first editor of it was Lord Lothian, at that time Philip Carr, K-E-R-R, and nobody knew this really for years. I got to know things, and I investigated that group, you see? Mm-hmm. Now, how I found it is very interesting. I noticed that prominent people in English life had Fellow of All Souls College. And so I decided I would study All Souls. This is purely historical. I got the names of all people who had been Fellows of All Souls since 1899 to whenever I was doing it, which would be about 1947. And there were 149 of them, you see. Now, these are the ones who remained forever after Fellows of All Souls, or in Lionel Curtis's case, he's the man who said, we've got to change the name from British Empire to Commonwealth of Nations. And the reason is they had been students of Alfred Zimmern, who wrote a book in 1909 called The Greek Commonwealth, describing ancient Greece, you see, and who was the man who made Arnold Toynbee a great classical scholar, do you see, and brought him into international affairs. Now, I knew none of this. All I knew is that here was a fellow, Lionel Curtis, who was such a poor student, it took him 15 years to get his degree, and then he got it about the lowest pass degree or something that you could ever get.
Mm. And here he was.
And nobody knew it. Company. Nobody had ever heard of him.
Right. But he was
furthermore,
an ordinary company.
I later discovered, furthermore, he was Lord Halifax's roommate at All Souls for years. Mm. And then I discovered this fella is behind everything that's going on. Lionel Curtis, you see? Mm. Now, I don't think we should talk too much about this.
Well, no, I...
You see? All right. But having discovered that, I met Alfred Zimmern. He came here to give a speech. And I said, isn't it funny that the All Souls, he said, that's the Round Table Group. I had never heard of them. That shows how little I knew it. They'd been around since 1909 and published this magazine since 1910, and this was 1947. Mm. And I said, what is the Round Table Group? He named them, who they were. And he says, I was a member of them for 10 years, from 1913, and they brought me in, invited me because I was in the Workers' Education Alliance. This was extension programs, night courses, summer courses for workers, Workers' Education Alliance. And he said, that's why they brought me into it, and I was for 10 years. And he says, I resigned in 1923 because they were determined to build up Germany against France. He says, I wouldn't stand for it, so I resigned. Now, when I met Lord Brand later and asked him about this, he had never seen about a resignation. Now, and so I better stop talking because, you see, this gets into all kinds of things. Now, I knew the Round Table Group was very influential. I knew that they were the real founders of the Royal Institute of International Affairs, and I knew they were all the stuff that's in print, that they were the real founders of the Institute of Pacific Relations. I knew that they were the godfathers of the Council on Foreign Relations here. Mm-hmm. So I began to put these things together and discovered that this group was working for the following things. They were a secret group. They were working to federate the English-speaking world, mm-hmm. the English-speaking world. Mm-hmm. They were closely linked to international bankers. they were working to establish a world, what I call a three-power world. And that three-power world was the Atlantic bloc of England and the Commonwealth and the United States, Germany, Hitler's Germany, Soviet Russia, the three-power world. They said, Germany we can control because it's boxed in, and all of this is in my book, it's boxed in between the Atlantic bloc and the Russians. The Russians will behave because they're boxed in between the Atlantic bloc, the American Navy and Singapore and so forth, and the Germans, do you see?
Right.
And therefore, now this is all described in my book, and this was their idea. Now notice, it's a balance of power system.
Mm.
They were largely, partly financed, for instance, by Rhodes, the Rhodes Trust. And how Milner got into this was he was the chief Rhodes trustee.
Mm.
From 1905, when he came back from Africa to his death in 1925. All right.
Okay.
So this was it's an Atlantic bloc. Strike. Clarence Strite, S-T-R-E-I-T, Union Now with Great Britain. All right, he represents what this group wanted. Clarence, S-T-R-E-I-T, if he's still alive, he probably lives in Washington. I had his daughter in my class, and as a visitor, but not as a student of mine. And he was built up by this people as the only solution. This is in my book, his name and when it happened. And
by the Roundtable people.
By the Roundtable people. And it was his book, Union Now, which came out in 1938, was called anonymously in the Roundtable magazine by Lionel Curtis, The Only Way it was headed. It was then reviewed anonymously in the Christian Science Monitor by Lord Lothian as the solution of our problems. And what it is essentially a union of the Atlantic bloc.
Not world domination.
Not world domination. Of course, this was Rhodes' idea.
Right.
He wanted the United States in the English Commonwealth. All right. Secondly, these people are not pro-communists as I know them. And certainly the Roundtable group and the Milner group and the people that I'm writing about, and I notice I followed them up only to 1940,
mm-hmm.
which is the end of the Morgan Bank when they had to incorporate because of the inheritance tax group, they had to incorporate. They were before that a partnership.
When did the Council of Foreign Relations form?
It was originally established by a group here about 1919,
okay.
But they had in the group that we went, it's the Inquiry. The Inquiry was the post-war planning group set up by the Morgan interests in 1917 in the United States, of which the technical head was the head of the American Geographical Society. The Inquiry got together in Paris and agreed to establish an organization out of which came the Royal Institute of International Affairs. And that Royal Institute of International Affairs had branches in all of the Commonwealth countries, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, Canada, eventually in India, and they even, I think, had one somewhere else. Pakistan, when it divided, they established one. But in the United States, of course, they didn't have to because they had the Council of Foreign Relations. But when they came over here, coming back from Paris, they found that a movement had begun here already to form a Council of Foreign Relations, so they moved in and took it over, and they could do that because they represented Morgan.
So without further ado, let's get into Tragedy and Hope. The first section is an introduction into Western civilization and its world setting. These first 22, 23, 24 pages is going to cover the different evolutions, the cultural evolutions of the civilizations, different empires, the rises and falls, you know, the different stages they go through and their characteristics. On page 22, specifically, he talks about the fact that there was a difference in development between Western Europe and the developments in Asia, and specifically Russia. And this is mainly due to the fact that they had different stages of the revolutions that they've gone through, meaning for Western Europe, you know, their Western ideology, their revolution in weapons, agricultural revolution, industrial revolution, revolution in sanitation and medicine, then the demographic explosion, then revolution in transportation and communications. these went in a different order in Asia. And because they went in the order they did in Western Europe, it led to, you know, essentially our constitutional republics and democracies, essentially. But he talks about Europe's shift in the 20th century, page 24. You know, he says the ideas that shaped Europe in the 20th century were the belief in the innate goodness of man, secularism, belief in progress, liberalism, capitalism, faith in science, democracy, and nationalism. Now, significantly, some of these ideas, the belief in the goodness of man, this was the essentially the belief that man is good, society is bad, that man's problems are external and not internal. It was, you know, if only man could be free, they felt, from corruption of society and its artificial conventions, freed from the burden of property, state, clergy, marriage, then man could rise to heights undreamed before and could indeed become practically a god. This was, you know, the belief that man could become God. This is the first lie ever told, which inevitably led to secularism and the idea of liberalism. This, again, is the idea that, you know, man is good, society is bad, that man needs to be free from all of the constraints of society and of tradition, all of them, which is, you know, eventually have led to the, you know, gender nonsense that we're dealing with, you know, today. You know, it even reaches that far. This led to the belief in the community of interest, this idea, and that was that human abilities are innate and can only be distorted or suppressed by social discipline, and that each individual is the best judge of his own self-interest. Now, this is significant because it leads to atomization and hyper individualism. No longer, you know, man being part of a society, for lack of a better word. And then there's, you know, the belief in science, or what we call scientism, which is essentially encompassed in empiricism, materialism, relativism. All this leads to pragmatism, which is essentially what Americanism is. This is what America is founded upon. And then significant is nationalism, which is what was needed to destroy the traditions of the symphonia of the church and the state. That specifically, you know, he says that nationalism acted as a disruptive force within such dynastic states as the Habsburg Empire or the Ottoman Empire, splitting these great states into a number of distinctive political units, otherwise nation states. So these ideas are classical liberalism. Even today's American conservatives, you are still by definition a liberal. But even still, the liberalism of centuries ago, like nationalism and such, it is considered extreme right all of a sudden. That's how far left we've moved. That's how far gone we have gone. You know, but these liberal ideas, you know, go back since the time of Bacon, Descartes, Voltaire, etc. This was necessary. This is what was that pulled man from his traditional society. And, you know, these ideas were fostered to break down the existing order, those dynastic monarchical orders. This allowed for a replacement of the existing order with a new order. But he says on page 27, this again changed with World War I. World War I, he says, brought about massive social changes to the world, involved multiple nation states, fought on multiple continents. And these, you know, what this did was completely flipped all those ideas on its side. He says on page 28 that instead of, you know, the belief that human nature is good, now it has switched to the idea that if man is left to himself, that man falls very easily to the level of the jungle or even lower. And he says this result can only be prevented by training and the coercive power of society. And thus man is capable of great evil, and now only society can prevent this. The belief that human abilities are innate and should be left free from social duress in order to display themselves has been replaced with the idea that human abilities are the result of social training and must be directed to socially acceptable ends. That liberalism is to be replaced by social discipline and planning. So by the end of World War I in 1919, this was the beginning stages of what they call technocracy. With the combination of conditioning and behaviorism, then man must be socially engineered. So to wrap up these ideas, liberalism was used to divorce man from the existing order and to restructure society away from throne and altar. World War I was necessary to bring in the next phase from liberalism to technocracy. Now, throughout this book, Quigley is going to tell us who was behind these revolutions and the World Wars and the Great Depression. He's going to let us know who is responsible for bringing us through these great social changes. But first, I want to highlight something he says on page 27 when describing how the First World War was the most important of all these events. And he says, accordingly, men were almost unanimous in 1919 at the end of World War I and their determination to restore the world of 1913, pre-World War I, and that this effort was a failure. Now, one reason why this is significant is one of the events that brought about, you know, Quigley needing to publish this book was due to the Rees Committee in the 1950s investigating tax-exempt foundations and their role in funding, quote, subversive activities. One of the chief investigators was a man by the name of Norman Dodd. Norman Dodd was the chief investigator for the Rees Committee investigating tax-exempt foundations in 1953. Prior to that, he was a bank manager tasked with restructuring banks after the 1929 stock market crash and actually worked in Morgan Banks. Now, he was investigating the Carnegie Foundation at the time, and they agreed to let him or one of his investigators read the meeting minutes. They said, we'll give you 2 weeks, you can send anybody you like, we'll give them a library, all the amenities necessary, and you can dig through all of our meeting notes since this inception of the foundation, and you can find whatever you want to. So he sends a lawyer named Catherine Casey, and he says, there's no way you're going to read 50 years of, you know, handwritten meeting minutes in 2 weeks. So he's, you know, he gives her an idea of what years to look for, and he says, check in these locations. And what she found was startling, and we'll listen to this, and we'll go back to what Quigley said about returning to World War One.
But I did explain to her that she couldn't possibly cover 50 years of handwritten minutes in 2 weeks. So she would have to do what we call spot reading. and I blocked out certain periods of time to concentrate on. And off she went to New York. She came back at the end of 2 weeks with the following in the way of on dictaphone belts. We are now at the year 1908, which was the year that the Carnegie began operations. And in that year, the trustees, meeting for the first time, raise a specific question, which they discuss throughout the balance of the year in a very learned fashion. And the question is there any means known more effective than war, assuming you wish to alter the life of an entire people? And they conclude that no more effective means than war to that end is known to humanity. So then in 1909 they raise the second question and discuss it, namely, how do we involve the United States in a war? Well, I doubt at that time if there was any subject more removed from the thinking of most of the people of this country than its involvement in a war. There were intermittent shows in the Balkans, but I doubt very much if many people even knew where the Balkans was. Then finally, they answer that question as follows. We must control the State Department. And then that very naturally raises the question of how do we do that? And they answer it by saying, we must take over and control the diplomatic machinery of this country. And finally, they resolve to aim at that as an objective. Then time passes, and we are eventually in a war, which would have been World War I. And at that time, they record on their minutes a shocking report in which they dispatched to President Wilson a telegram cautioning him to see that the war does not end too quickly. And finally, of course, we are, the war is over. At that time, their interest shifts over to preventing what they call a reversion of life in the United States to what it was prior to 1914 when World War I broke out. And they arrive at that point, they come to the conclusion that to prevent a reversion, we must control education in the United States. And they realize that that's a pretty big task.
There's quite a bit of publicity given to your conversation with Rowan Gaither. Would you please tell us who he was and what was that conversation you had with him?
Rowan Gaither was at that time president of the Ford Foundation. And Mr. Gaither had sent for me when I found it convenient to be in New York, asked me to call upon him at his office, which I did. And on arrival, after a few amenities, Mr. Gaither said, Mr. Dodd, we've asked you to come up here today because we thought that possibly, off the record, you would tell us why the Congress is interested in the activities of foundations such as ourselves. And before I could think of how I would reply to that statement, Mr. Gaither then went on voluntarily and stated, he said, Mr. Dodd, all of us that have a hand in the making of policies here have had experience either with the OSS during the war or the European Economic Administration after the war. We've had experience operating under directives, and these directives emanate and did emanate from the White House. Now we still operate under just such directives. Would you like to know what the substance of these directives is? And I said, yes, Mr. Gaither, I'd like very much to know. Whereupon he made this statement to me, namely, Mr. Dodd, we are here operate on similar, in response to similar directives, the substance of which is that we shall use our grant-making power so to alter life in the United States that it can be comfortably merged with the Soviet Union.
So again, we have Carol Quigley telling us how World War I has altered the life of man. And then we have cooperation with Norman Dodd in investigating large endowments that they indeed consciously wanted to alter life in America. and determined that the war was the only way possible. And in doing so, they also wanted to prevent a reversion to life in America pre-World War I. And this is why Quigley said any attempts to restore order back to prior to 1913 was indeed a failure. So the significance of what Norman Dodd found in investigating these large endowments named after the titans of banking and industry in the United States is going to be fleshed out in this book. And again, Quigley is acting as an apologist for the people that were behind the revolutions, American and French, the two world wars, and the stock market crash of 1929. And so that is the end of the first section, a brief introduction into, you know, Western civilization up until 1914. The first few parts of his book is just bringing all of the different civilizations up to World War I. He's going to go through Western civilization. He's going to get into the Russian Empire. He's going to talk about Britain. And he's going to lead you through the history of all these different people groups and how they got to where they were, leading everything up to World War I. But the next section of the first part is going to be the rise of the banking elite. But I am going to end this episode here. This was just a quick introduction into Carroll Quigley and who he was, and Tragedy and Hope, what it's going to be about, and that it is their story as told from their archives and their perspective.
Yes. Now, what it means is this. I think it is absolutely tragic. It is shameful. It is sinful that Western civilization is going to go down the drain. When I wrote that book, which is less than 10 years ago, I had hope that we could save Western civilization. I am extremely skeptical now that it can be saved. I think we're just about finished.